Hi, I'm Felicia, not Uncle Martinez. It's nice to see some of you again, and it's always such a pleasure to be here at the City Club. And Sina, thank you as always for your amazing staff, this amazing venue, and all that you provide for our community. Really appreciate that. It's my pleasure today to introduce Dr. Peggy Pesci. And she is the senior researcher at the University of Bavaria. She's representing the Academy for Advancement of African Studies. Is that correct? Yeah. She's a board member of EDFRA, which is an organization about representing black women in Germany. She's played a pivotal role in the establishment of black German and black European studies. So she's pretty, deeply rooted in those sorts of, representing those sorts of studies. She's had numerous publications, most recently an article in the forthcoming book, Remapping Germany. So you may want to look that up, especially if you enjoy her talk today. Get a copy of that, and I'm sure that your publisher would really enjoy that as well, right?
Absolutely.
She taught in the U.S. for a while at Vassar and at Hamilton College. And so, Peggy, we are so pleased to have you today, and we have this opportunity because of this being brought to our attention at the Germanic Studies at the University of Colorado by Dr. Beverly Weber. And Emily, I'm not sure, are you a PhD as well?
I'm a PhD.
Yes, and so Emily initially wrote and said, would you be interested? And so we're really, really pleased that that happened. And I would say to anyone in the audience, if there's ever an EU sort of representation event that represents the EU in some way, we would love to hear about that, and see what we can do about setting the stage for that. Okay, Dr. Pesci.
Thank you very much for this very kind introduction. Very happy to be here and to share my thoughts and my perspective on the European Union and the European Union. Okay, I'm being signaled I have to speak a little louder. I will try that. And the current affairs around the migrant movement. And I will speak to that a little bit more, why I use this kind of terms and terminology and language. I brought with me on a first little video clip, which is in German, but actually the lyrics is not, they are not so complicated. It's actually a kind of an ironic intervention into the more violent and right-wing movement in Germany right now, in contrast and in a protest of migrants coming to Germany. So it is by, it's actually kind of a persiflage of a very famous song in Germany. Heroes Like Us, and they remixed the lyrics, and it's basically to say, how stupid can you actually be? You need to actually reconsider and go back to learn some history and maybe also some language. You need a dictionary, I am, that would be her. I am just ashamed of that you are my fellow citizen. I brought you this short clip just to give you also a visual impression, which I think is helpful for the discussion, which shows us some of the images which are not just underlying the discussion and debates, but which are actually driving the debates right now, which are, you know, informing the debates. And images are usually more and more universal, so you will recognize a lot of codes which we then can also, you know, deconstruct and break down. Because a lot of the images we have already, of course, in mind, and we get presented every day by the media. What I found particularly intriguing of this with this video is that it combines two very important discussions and two very important dots of the debates right now, with focus on Germany, but I'm also going to speak about Europe in greater detail. On the one hand, as you saw, the atmosphere, which is really heating up, which is kind of more getting more and more violent, getting more and more explicit, and also really leaving the frame of an consensus of criticism and debates here. On the other hand, you have a side of a discussion and a strategy which was being tried now for, well, almost 2 or 3 years now, to maybe even belittle a little bit, or to kind of ironically compare, or ironically to contrast and comment on these very right-wing, more and more violent movements. That turned out not to be the best strategy to get in, to actually tackle some of the topics and the arguments of this more growing movement in Germany. As you saw at the end, it was also a presentation in an in a club of satire where professional comedians were at work, and that was that is very much where certain kinds of criticism of this right-wing movement, which is faster growing in Europe right now, is actually being discussed. So that cannot be enough, because that means it is kind of outsourced to cultural places of intellectual criticism where not the whole society can take part in. I should say in the beginning that I'm not an scholar of political science, or I'm not in economics, I'm not in international affairs. I'm rather coming from a cultural studies perspective, and of course from a Black German political community-driven perspective. So as an activist and scholar, I am involved in these debates for longer than it now appeared in a larger public sphere, because some of the aspects we are dealing with right now were already prominent for the communities of Black people and people of color throughout Europe for decades now. Maybe what I also want to say beforehand is just to clarify a couple of definitions or terms and a language which I'm using. I rather speak of migrants and migrations than of refugee and refugees, because that is an important difference with regard to agency. It is also a difference with regard to a political perspective. Migration actually takes the speaker with the content. You cannot outsource basically and create an author so strongly with the word of migration, because that always already combines, it always has an alliances of territories, of movement, and by that also of subjects, and it speaks of two sides of subjects. While refugee, and certainly the way we are discussing it in throughout Europe, puts the agency on the speaker sides, and which usually is either the parliamental political level, or European Union parliamental level, or the media side, and the object position on the people who are then being labeled as refugee, which is, by the way, language always matters in German, also as a word which actually takes agency away. refugee in German means Flüchtling, and the ending of Ling is never something of a person which is actually in control and charge of their own acting. So we have that only assigned to very few labeling of people. One would be, for example, also the German word for so-called mixed race, which is of course also problematic, but that would be actually a word which is only otherwise assigned in the realm of animals. So you see that language does matter, and especially in a German public debate, this word of refugee is really highly problematic. Another word which already, I think, was highlighted in my title, in the title about my talk today, is crisis. And here especially how we use it in conjunction with which adjective, in other words, whose crisis is it? And that would be my first argument here, my first thesis, that I think we have a crisis in Europe and we have a crisis of Europe. So it is actually what I do refuse very, very strongly, that we do have a refugee crisis, because that, for what I already said, puts actually it outsources all the problems which we have, which I try to lay out a little bit more. The crisis of Europe is what I see is in a context between Europe as a geographical entity and Europe as a concept. And this Europe as a concept is, of course, pretty old now. As we know, it is when, if we boil it down to its core, it is always informed by the intellectual and philosophical tradition of the Enlightenment. But it also it took basically for 300 years to develop this concept of Europe, what it means, who is part of Europe, and how does Europe defines itself, be it via religion, via culture, whatever that means. It was negotiated throughout the centuries in different ways, and of course always linked to the political situations at the time, to the extent of alliances, and of course status of enemies, and remapping the place through war. I would argue that we see a final shaping of the concept of Europe sometimes around the end of the 19th century, and we could look at, for example, that would be a very fruitful beginning to understand what we deal with also right now, is to look into the so-called Berlin Conference in 1884, which was also infamously known as the Congo Conference, where the European empires got together to remap basically the colonies, with an emphasis on the African continent. The history behind is that the new rising star in Europe, so to speak, the newest member on the table of the European empires, was Germany, which then invited all the other empires to come to Berlin and to negotiate Germans' parts of colonies, as being seen as the knighthood of becoming an empire. Basically, as we know, to put it out simple, was that Chancellor Bismarck basically threatened the rest of Europe. We could go to war over these colonies, or we could just, you know, come to an agreement. What is important about these negotiations is that it actually meant that Europe decided for the first time to define itself as an entity, as something like, let's say, a family, and say we are rather keep the peace here, we are rather even a family which maybe doesn't like each other so much, but you know, we keep it together and we cut up pieces in the world. That was for the first time, and we can also see then how, you know, if we revisit what just happened, the events which led to World War I, that in this understanding of Europe, then of course individual or regional interests were negotiated, and it basically blew up, which was so little expected for everybody. So it was no, that World War I happened the way it happened, one could also argue was after the Berlin Conference, it wasn't possible anymore to have this kind of wars within Europe, what they were used to it. So Germany and France go to war, or Austria and the Balkans go to war. No, it wasn't possible anymore, but then if some conflict was inflicted, it spread throughout the whole continent. This is, of course, a very frightening scenario if we think about that. This is the concept of Europe we have here right now, and I would argue that. The way what came together, if we stay with this comparison or this initial birth moment of the modern concept of Europe, would be that the founding ideas of this concept was not so much religion or saying we are all a Christian nations. That was there before, but it was actually whiteness. It was the whiteness of Europe versus the blackness of Africa, of course, and the otherness of, there were also other parts of the world and colonies being divided at the time. And this is what we see right now, that actually the center and the map of this whiteness is negotiated right now in Europe. And this is happening already over, I would say, the last decade. What we see now is really the fragility of this concept in Europe, which then feels itself so much under threat and under siege that we see events like in Germany, that so many asylum homes and shelters are being burned, and it is just really a miracle that nobody died yet there, and that we see so much more violence is growing throughout Europe. We see the more and more harsher responses by European Union members to go back to national border controls, which is highly problematic and actually undermines the whole notion of the European Union. So one could also just argue that European Union is actually, as a sovereign entity, a failed entity. Because if that would happen in any other state, that is would actually exactly being considered so the national, or in this sense international, sovereign government is cannot implement laws anymore, as we see now what is happening in Hungary or in Austria, that they make decisions against the decisions on the European Union level. What I think, well, let me point that out, this development of the a notion of whiteness in crisis. I would say that we see that already since about a decade, and it started with the time of the European Union expansion, towards the east to include the Eastern European countries. And when that began, we were talking about countries like Poland, Romania, Bulgaria, Hungary, Czech Republic, and Slovakia. And especially with regard to Bulgaria, but also Romania, there started already a very complex debate in Western Europe about the rights of the new European Union citizen coming to Western Europe and being also able to claim residency and to get a work permission, because actually the other way around, to not need a work position anymore. Because as a citizen of the European Union, one has the right to travel everywhere and to relocate everywhere. Well, since the European Union did start to have this two level of citizenship, to say, well, you can do that, but the people from the other countries can't do that. These debates about the so-called threat from Romania or from Bulgaria turned into a very strange discussion, because it was not named who was actually being labeled as the threat. And it turned out that the concentration was actually on the Roma population in these countries. So that was the first time, basically, without really naming the names, Europe renegotiated or felt like that this universal notion of its whiteness is being under threat here. Because, of course, these people were also member of, and not member, but citizen of a European Union country. They were not being seen as part of the European Union. These threats and understanding of threats continued into discussions and debates we just, I would say temporarily ended with respect to the monetary crisis in Europe, and here with the question of whether Greece can get the support it needed to recover in its monetary problems of its own country, or if it should leave the not the EU but the monetary union. The language which is being used in these discussions, beyond the question, beyond the detailed thematic questions of the household and the finance context behind that, this language was in the continuation of a remapping of the we and actually outsourcing a group which was no longer profitable for the European Union. So Greece suddenly was moved at the fringe of whiteness, at the fringe of the concept of Europe. And that is also one reason that it seems to be so easy to leave Greece right now pretty much alone with the problem of handling groups of migrants landing in Greece. This is what we see for right now. And it actually culminates in the debates around how to handle the number of migrants coming to Europe right now and who actually are allowed to pass through the borders which are closing as we speak, as we know. That we see here that the language being talked about is using this threat from Northern Africa, using that as, you know, where Europe has to put its new frontier to set border controls already on the African continent, but and also going into negotiations with African countries. That was just happened a couple of months ago, where the European Union negotiated with several African countries to take migrants back when they are captured somewhere on the European continent. Probably not even as a result, but actually as a matter of fact, there are almost no African migrants who make it to Europe, and that already for years now, that actually the majority of migrants, as we know, come from Syria. But the language and the way we debate that is still be coded by the threat of blackness towards conquering Europe as a geographical unit, but also as an a concept. What made me thinking here, what is really important to point out is that there are comparison possible with developments within Europe, but especially in Germany after World War II, where we find a lot of continuing strategies. And that would be with respect to the so-called guest worker program in West Germany, which of course connected and combined the development of post-World War II West European countries. There was a huge labor shortage in West Germany and a need for work and labor in other Western European countries like Spain, Portugal, Greece, Italy, and also Turkey. As we know from the development that throughout the time that these families and the next generations mostly integrated into the German social system with regard to citizenship, for example, certainly for children of so-called guest workers, except for the Turkish community. So we now deal in Germany still with a third generation of Turkish-German community who do not have the same legal rights as other Germans and also other descendants from this program 50 years ago. And that, of course, has a long tradition in racializing and othering the Turkish-German community and Turkey with that regard as well. So not only come these different historical threats together now in the new started negotiations of between the European Union and Turkey, to what extent and when and actually if Turkey would be able to join the European Union in treaty with border control and basically becoming the migration center of Europe. That is the idea, to actually keep most of the migrants in Turkey, and Turkey would take these obligations to keep the people on their side and then try to get better conditions or finally being eligible for joining the European Union. I don't think that will happen. Is actually pretty clear when you follow the European Union debates, when you follow the debates in the parliament in Brussels, but also in the larger Western European countries led by Germany, because this is where actually Germany would have to step up with its history of the guest workers program and its unsolved relationship with its own Turkish-German population. And we don't hear that. We don't hear clear signals on an idea that Turkey could become a member of the European Union anytime soon. So we do see connections of these historical threats on all sides, but not only here, but we can also see how a new group of migrants is being already divided and being treated differently, as we saw that 50 years ago. These are all observations which are very important to keep in mind when it comes to questions of how to solve the problems of, obviously we have problems on the borders, on the question of quotes and contingents to take migrants in the different European countries, but it is also important to see that as an underlying blueprint when we try to look at how European countries can talk with each other, because we basically are back to this level of an national or binational discussions and not so much on the level of a European Union discussion. Let me just to close with make another very important reference to the economic aspect. As I said in the beginning, I'm not in economics. I don't know the hard numbers here. But I do know the statistics in Germany, and I'm very sure that they are not so much different in Europe. That especially for Germany, this so-called new wave, this larger movement, or sometimes it is also be seen as or discussed as irregular movement or irregular or illegal immigrations, they are actually much needed, economically speaking. Germany is a large country which is more and more aging. We are not having enough people in the labor force, so our well-preserved system of retirement and social contract system, which Germany is so incredible proud of, is actually in stake here right now. It's not clear whether in 20 years from now it can actually still be operative, because we do have a huge disbalance between an older and growing older population and a younger generation actually entering the workforce, and by that, you know, entering the monetary aspect of the social contract. So the everybody in economy, in between politics and economy in Germany is actually happy for the people who are coming. And then the really to crunch the numbers of what it would cost to give people enough skills to be able to function in the workforce, which is of course a language training and some legal training, what everybody has to do when you are relocate somewhere, is nothing in comparison to what these development will bring for the German demographic, and by that, of course, the German society over a course of just a couple of decades, so two or three decades, what we speak here. And that is actually a kind of a hidden number. It's not discussed very openly, but it is openly accessible. I have to point that out. It is not always my first choice to argue for a larger migration and acceptance of migration, and also changing the laws towards an immigration status, to turn Germany into, finally, to legally clarify the fact that we are a country of immigration. So the economic aspect would not be always my first argument for it, to say, you know, it pays out for. But right now the debates are going so dangerously out of hand and so dangerously in feeding into a growing circle of violence that we also have to shed light on exactly that. We have so there's so much false information out on the status of the people who are coming. For example, most of these people are highly educated, what of course ethically is basically irrelevant. Even for somebody who does not have a university degree, has a right to survive and has a right to seek also a better life. What Germans are so afraid of, that it is being taken away from them. So in the light of this, all is actually what where I would say we need to discuss this crisis right now, and it would be very powerful if we could, you know, refocus and reshape our perspective and acknowledge that we do have a problem in Europe, of Europe, and that we need to tackle it from this side. Well, that would be my input, and I'm happy to discuss.
You were mentioning two decades, and so one of the questions that I had Europe or Germany in particular going to be suffering for two decades, and then after the two decades, is the literature suggesting, the economists suggesting there, that that is the time there that you'd have an accelerating gross domestic product?
No, not really. What the two decades are actually with reference to the social contract in Germany. So if we are not changing anything right now, our social security system in Germany will break down in two decades. That's the point. And there is no suffering, and that is the other side, that actually, you know, if you see the numbers, for example, what would cost right now to take the actual accurate number of people who are seeking asylum and who are seeking a place in Europe, which are not the ones what the tabloids tell us, that millions are on the move. And compare that with the costs of the border control right now. And it means the local border control right now, for example, what just happened a couple of days ago between Macedonia and Greece, for example. But also the European Union organized and navigated border controls through the on the Mediterranean. Then it becomes obvious that there is a misrepresentation. It costs 77 million what we do right now in order to keep the people out, and it would cost 10 million, for example, for Germany to set up everything we need to get the people in just the general life and in the workforce.
I have a question on the German level and the European level. On the German level, I can't think of any other country who's done more to acknowledge the sins, if that's the right word, of the past than Germany has. It's totally open up there. And my German question is, from the outside looking in, almost seems like it's, in a sense, committing national suicide from the standpoint of trying to make up, if that's the right word, for the sins of the past. Merkel has been so open. Of course, she initiated Welcome Flüchtlinger, and that started the wave there. And then you see the regional reaction, like last week, I think it was last week or two, the regional elections in Germany went highly towards the alternative party, right? The right-wing party. Now, Merkel is up for a national election, I think, in 18 months.
Yes.
Do you see that this phenomenon can continue here, this welcoming? And I know it's turning now. So that's the German question. The European question is, well, at least I think, that Schengen, is time is almost over here. We're going to have national borders again. I don't think it's any more of a question. I don't see any alternative to national borders going back up. We see it already. And you referred to the Greece-Macedonia thing last week. You've got people behind barbed wire fences just break on through with their battering rams, and it's just a matter of time that it's Europe now is going to be just so inundated. And I think you're correct. It's not so much North Africa, it's more Middle East, Syrian, other issues there. And the European question is, the EU seems to me makes not much economic sense in the long run. I don't think it's stable. But as a political statement or political affiliation, it makes great sense to avoid the World War I's of the world, right? So the European question is, do you really see it surviving? A is an economic force and B is a political.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we don't have an alternative. And that's also what I see as a general answer since we entered this monetary crisis, which really hits everybody hard in Europe. Not so much with regard to the economic aspects, because actually it didn't felt so hard, certainly not in Germany, but also in most Western European countries, but as a possibility, you know, for the first time as a possibility that Europe could fail. But maybe you could compare it to the other options on the table in 2008 here in the US and this infamous notion of too big to fail, you know. What was behind there was from a certain perspective to say we have no other alternative, you know. Maybe that is something to comprehend the necessity of Europe to survive, you know. To what extent it would be what you just suggested, that economically there is no future, but politically, well, I think that is, first of all, you can't divide that. It is absolutely entangled. Mm-hmm. And second, what I would say is what we see throughout this different aspects of crisis of Europe is that it all what it is, what European Union, all what it is an economic entity. We never really achieved to be a political entity. There is this big dream about, you know, the European, United States of Europe, also to be a counterweight to the U.S. or China or Russia, but once these aspects of the crisis hits hard, it turned out there is no political strong enough in our position, and I'm also not so sure, you know, to say Schengen is death. If Schengen is really death, then this concept is gone. Mm-hmm. You know, it's also interesting to see which countries, you know, call for national sovereignty. Well, everybody still has national sovereignty, but call for, you know, a national control of borders again so easily. You know, it's either the younger European countries, you know, it's only the younger European countries and Austria, you know, mm-hmm. Who all would not survive a very long time to going back to this, you know, mm-hmm. small little states. So I would say that there is no alternative to the model of Schengen and a European Union, because otherwise the balance system will be shaked up there.
Oh, that's scary.
Yes, it's a scary scenario.
I like to watch the parliament, the debates in the EU with the UKIP party, for instance, out of the UK, and the Geert Wilders in Holland and all that.
Right. And this is, for example, that you're bringing something into the discussion right now with UK. We will see that, you know. We first had the first side was last year when Scotland discussed whether to, you know, to get out of UK, out of the Commonwealth, and they decide not to do that.
Close.
Very close, exactly. If UK now will, you know, step out of the European Union, we will see, you know, how that will affect that. Well, to the German question, I also disagree with you on this notion of that I like the term, but I don't think it's accurate of national suicide, you know, to of Germany.
Selbstmord.
Yeah. And national suicide is an interesting term, but I don't see that Germany would do that, you know, because with, you know, just to begin with the European Monetary Union, you know, the countries which are benefited the most from that was Germany, was the Netherlands, was France, you know. And we need to keep ask the question, how was it possible to actually enter this monetary union with such weak national finances as Greece, Italy, and Spain brought to the table? So there was an interest, and that was not only a political, it was an economic interest. And Germany, as the largest economic engine in Europe, cannot be, you know, just defined as an national independent engine. Mm-hmm. Germany is that strong because of the European Union, because of Schengen, you know, because of the monetary union. Mm-hmm. And we also do see that when you look into how the recovery pact with Greece was created, you know, who benefits from that, you know, everything what Greece has to sell now, you know, national airports, basically everything which was still profitable for the national economy in Greece is basically handed to some of the corporations in Western Europe now as a contract, part of the contract for the economic recovery. So Germany does not commit national suicide on this level, you know, in the sense of that is absolutely true. We are, you know, paying most of the larger chunk of what is now being used for this crisis, but that is also in relation, you know, we couldn't ask Austria to pay that money.
Yeah, but it just seems that that's the driver behind those regional elections going to the right wing. For instance, in Germany, is that recognition.
Right, and you just said, you know, with regard to the election that it turned out good to be very good for the alternative party. That really frightens me. I really hope that it is not becoming an alternative party. You know, it's a new right-wing movement.
That will overwhelm the CDU in a year and a half. Anyway, I hope you're right, but as they say, interesting times.
Interesting times, yes, in a very problematic way. You know, just a last note. I personally think that Angela Merkel will survive that. Mm-hmm. And also due to the fact that we don't have an alternative. Okay. And that is for me the most surprising outcome of this last couple of years, to see that, you know, with Angela Merkel, we have a voice of reason there, mm-hmm. you know, and she is very much driven by, of course, not her personal, but by the experience and being able to actually make that politically fruitful, you know, of her background of East Germany, which I share with her. I also grew up in East Germany. And the events after the wall came down. You know, because, and she doesn't say it out loud, I wish she would, you know, to remind us more clearly, you know, that especially the people in East Germany who are protesting so extremely and really going close to violence now and actually overstepped these lines already, to remind all of us, you know, that we would not be here if just half of you would have responded the way we do right now in 1990. You know, we would not have this Germany to complain about.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I'm wondering how strong the analogy would be, or if it's correct at all. In this country, I feel like there's a huge separation between our policies on immigration and, or migration as we call, and the fact that so much of our economy is dependent on undocumented workers, and that if more pressure could be put there, that those two processes have to come into alignment rather than this totally obvious but never spoken about, apparently. Do you see that being the same type of thing in Europe?
Yeah, I think the dynamics behind that are quite similar, what you said, to the situation in the US and what we saw in the debates on the Dream Act and how it then was crumbled. You know, the idea behind that was, you know, that the US is relying so much, you know, on undocumented workers, and at the same time to trying to close in here. So it's actually a paradox, you know. So if you actually would implement all of these laws, you know, the economy would crumble on here. We don't have that yet in Europe, as the numbers are much smaller, but the analogy is quite similar in the sense that certainly in some of the Western European countries, it is different in Spain, where a large percentage of young people is there and there is no work. So it's actually, this is a different situation. But it is certainly true for Germany as this most important biggest economic engine in Europe, that we actually rely and we need to rely on this. This is a chance now, what is coming. And we see that also, that, you know, there is a more hidden discourse that, you know, the economy is trying, you know, to make everything possible to open up that, and it is then translated into the media like, yeah, highly qualified people should come, and yes, they should get the legalization very easily, but it is again retransported in a way where I would say we need to be very careful. We had this before, about 15 years, now 20 years ago, when the Conservative Party went into election to go against high qualified IT people from India, you know, and there's actually the election, the campaign slogan was rhyming in German, it rhymes, you know. We want, you know, children instead of Indians, you know. So that it was terrible, you know, and it really also economically and politically failed, you know. Besides the question that, you know, I was ashamed for that, and this, I think it is ethically and politically just wrong. But we ended exactly up with people didn't want to come, you know. I would say, you know, no, please, you know, this is not an atmosphere we don't feel welcome here. Of course, we have a large number of people who are not as privileged to say, well, you know, if you can't resolve your own inner political problems, then don't bother us with that. But it also extends, you know, to other areas. You know, we have highly influential scientific organizations like the Max Planck Institute, for example, you know, who are raising the questions already very high and say, you know, we don't get people to come here anymore because it's an atmosphere of hate, it's an atmosphere of violence, you know. Certainly the centers which are in East Germany.
To put back things on the aspect of whiteness, I'm wondering if the pushback, in spite of all the economic figures that you give and all the logics of it, if there's a pushback in Europe to the refugees and immigration, because people just don't recognize, don't see their citizenry or the social environment that it was 20 years ago or 30 years ago. I see that in France, where people make the comment of saying, this is like a North African market now. You know, I go to the market and I feel like I'm in Morocco. And I'm wondering if, like, the younger country that came to into the EU don't have even more of that, because they've been less impacted, or not impacted, or less, there's been less immigration over the past 30 years. And you have ethnic, white ethnic groups, I mean white groups in all through Europe, where compared to the US, for example, where it has always been a mix, not always, but it has been for the longest time, that there is more acceptance of new immigration. When in Europe, it's like, well, I don't recognize my town, I don't recognize my village, I don't recognize my city, or I don't recognize my market. And that there is that social backlash that trumps all economic figures, and say, okay, if the numbers are working like you're saying, it makes sense to get more people. Well, ultimately, we don't want to do that because of that aspect. And if you do that, there will be even more people coming in. And that will be in spite of all the logic and all the benefits and everything. So I'm asking about, how do you see that trumping the,
so to speak,
all the data?
Basically, what you describe is actually, I mean, I think, yeah, that's all the dynamics which are at work. But that's just what defines what racism is, mm-hmm. You know, because we are not talking about other movement. Movement always was throughout Europe, you know, and that is what also Schengen then legalized, you know, and as long as you are white and Belgian, you know, you can relocate everywhere and nobody says anything. And it's also not just, you know, because then immediately the counter argument is, yeah, but that's not in this large numbers. That's also not true, as we know. I mean, we had in 1945 one of the largest, you know, inner European migration movement, and we had this in 1988 until 1990, you know, which led to the collapse of the Eastern European bloc. You know, so it does have to do, you know, with this notion of the other, with basically, yeah, again, it comes down to whiteness. You know, and in Poland, there are areas now where it is very lucrative, where only Germans go there, you know, for recreation, and even the clinics are provided everything in German, because the Germans can't be bothered to learn Polish. So that is, we don't see that, you know, like, and we don't recognize our town anymore, you know. But we do will see, you know, if we are not finally get to the core of the problem, we do will see how it always has, you know, an a triggering effect. It's always a kind of a domino effect then, which is behind that. So now it is, you know, the clear we and the other is very much shaped out. But that's why I say it's really a crisis of whiteness. The center is renegotiated, the margins are renegotiated, and of course fringes are assigned to, you know. And right now it is of course France which is at the fringe. Countries like Bulgaria are at the fringe because they have a too large population, you know, a demographic of non-white people. But it starts already in something which we consider to be the center. I mean, we just had, at the same time where the so-called refugee crisis was negotiated, the UK tried to kind of, you know, convince Europe into its requests to stay in the European Union. At the same time, we had debates about limitations of Polish migrants to the UK, you know, in terms of what kind of social security benefits they could get, you know, mm-hmm. which is again also against the European Union laws, mm-hmm. you know. So UK got an exception rule, you know. So it as actually, if somebody is committing a kind of an institutional suicide, it's the European Union with these kind of acts, you know. Mm-hmm. And David Cameron went back home and was very proud of, you know, being successful to negotiate this exceptions for UK. Poland was of course not happy, I mean, understandable, you know. But this is, you know, where you see it comes back home, you know. Mm-hmm. It will hit home. So we are already now in these kind of very destructive conversations even in the center. Mm-hmm.